Welcome to the second module of Points Topology course, part 1. This is an NOC course of NPTEL. So today's topic is norm linear spaces. Recall that we use this notation K for either the set of real numbers or the set of complex numbers. Amongst all properties of the modulus function on K, you know, you talk about modulus of Z, which is equal to what? X plus X square plus Y square, and then you take the square root. Okay. So there are modulus functions on both R and C. So I am trying to handle both of them together. So what is the striking properties of this modulus function? I would like to list three of them. The first thing is that modulus of any non-negative modulus is always a non-negative real number. Whether x is a real number or a complex number, mod x is a non-negative real number. It is zero if and only if x is zero. So that is the first property. Second property is if you multiply by some number r times x, then the modulus of that is modulus of r into modulus of x. I deliberately write r and x instead of x and y because the multiplication, this r, is supposed to be scalar multiplication. It is not a real number. It is real or complex, no problem. But just to indicate that they have different roles here. Okay. So that's why I'm writing R here. That's all. R, even if you write modulus of XY is less than is equal to mod X mod Y, it's correct. That's no problem. Okay, but don't take R as a real number. It is both for real and complex number. And the third property, modulus of x plus y is always less than mod x plus mod y. Okay. So these things we have been using all the time. That is why they are the most important ones. So these properties will be now taken and made into an axiom. Okay. So that is what we are going to do. Okay. So I already told you that what I'm going to do in, if it is not real, K is not real, but K is C, and C can take in as R cross R. Namely, every complex number can be written as real part, comma, imaginary part, X, comma, Y. Then mod Z is nothing but square root of X square plus Y square. Okay. So this looks like I have the same modulus function, same property, wherein K could be R or R square, but no, you can do it for all Rn. So that is the whole idea. Easily generalized to all Rn, right? How, if you just take a vector now, an n vector, x equal to x1, x2, xn, all x1, xn, xn are real numbers. Just like when n was 2, this was real part and imaginary part of a complex number. So in more general case, you have n coordinate real numbers here, the coordinates of x, they are all real. Then I denote it for, you know, future reference also, this norm x2, that 2 indicates that I am going to take squares here and then square root here. Okay, take the squares of each xi, sum it up, then take the square root. This is what is called as Euclidean norm. Okay, so you can, we have just generalized the complex number modulus into any you can call it as a modulus. So just to confuse, instead of calling it as modulus, you don't get confused. So I'm having a different notation here, that's all. So the same properties can be checked, namely this norm now. Norm x is non-negative real number. It is 0 if and only if x is 0. Now x is 0 means what? Each x1, x2, xn are all 0. Similarly, now it comes down, I can't take r as x1, x2, xn, r1, r2, rn, and x as x1, x2, xn. No. X will be taken as x1, x2, xn. R will be now taken only from k. Either it is a complex number or it is just a real number. Now I want to take real number because all xi's I have taken real number. So this is the second property. Third property is again x plus y is the same thing. X1, x2, xn plus y1, y2, yn here will be x1 plus y1, x2 plus y2, xn plus yn. The norm of that instead of modulus is less than the norm of x plus norm of y. So these are the properties which will be, these three properties which will be carried out for this norm function also. This number two. Okay. So many of you have seen this one. I am just listing it. This x2 norm is non-negative and it's zero if and only if all the coordinates are zero. R times norm x is modulus of r times norm x. R is inside now real number and x is Rn. Norm of x plus y, namely this 2 norm, is less than equal to norm of x plus norm of y. Okay. So this was all right when the easy step. What we want to take the first step is something more substantial. That is our first general step of generalization. What is this? This norm linear spaces is what we are going to define. So what, instead of taking Rn, what we want to take is any vector space over K. So I can take C cross C also, okay? So in that case, this R will become a complex number. Then also this makes sense. That is what we want to do. So take any vector space over K, okay? K is a field, okay? Whether K is R or C, it is a field. We have to take a vector space over K. Need not be even finite dimensional. It could be infinite dimensional also. Okay, take any vector space. So by a norm function on V, we mean a function. This is a somewhat, this notation is not functional notation, but this is the way we would like to write. Namely, this is the slot for the function. Okay, so norm is dependent from this vector space into what? Non-negative real numbers, the closed interval 0 to open infinity. Okay, this entire ray here, that is the codomain. So a function which satisfies these three hypotheses, n1, n2, n3, n for norm. Okay, what are they? They are exactly the same thing as what we have seen here. Same thing as what we have seen for the modulus function here. Okay, the very easy thing that we have done, the same property we write here, only we have to take care here, namely, the x is a vector, x is always inside V, but r there, whatever r appears, I have written deliberately now alpha, which alpha is a scalar in the field, whether K is either R or C. Okay, the first one is positive definiteness is the name. Norm X is 0 if and only if X is 0. The positive part corresponds to that it is taking non-negative numbers here. It is 0 if and only if X equals 0 is definiteness. Okay. Okay, these are standard terminologies here. The homothesis says that scalar multiplication, then take the norm is the same thing as multiplying by the modulus of the scalar into the norm of x. Okay, this happens for every alpha in scalar and every vector. The third one is again a copy of the corresponding third property there. It has a name, triangle inequality, which is derived from the two-dimensional, you know, school geometry. If you take a triangle, the sum of the two sides is always slightly bigger than or equal to the third side. So that is what this triangle inequality means here. Norm of x plus y is less than equal to norm of x plus norm of y. These x and y are now arbitrary vectors inside this vector space. When you have such a function, it's called a norm. Together with such a function, the vector space V will be called a normed linear space. Okay, this is standard terminology now. Nobody else speaks about anything else. Earlier, in the development of these things, there are different names and so on. Okay, let us have some examples here. What are called as LP norms. See now, why I denoted this x with a with norm x here with a 2, that will be clear here. Instead of this 2, I would like to write any positive real number. Okay, I would like to, but I cannot. I will have to restrict myself, namely p greater than or equal to 1. So suppose it's 1, then what is the meaning of this? This is summation modulus of xi I have to take. Don't take xi with as they are. If square was okay, real number square are already positive, non-negative, so you don't have to take modulus. But the correct thing is to take always modulus. Then it will work for complex numbers also. Okay, so this thing, which is very simple, has to be correctly generalized and correctly modified. So instead of 2, I can write p here, then modulus of xi raised to p, then instead of square root, what should I do? I should put a p at the root, raise to the p here, and then take the p at the root of that. That is what I am doing here. Come here, modulus of xi raised to p, take the summation, take the 1 by p at the root, and p at the root of that, of the total summation. So that will define again a norm is the claim here. So what you have to verify? You have to verify that if I put this whole thing to 0, then all the xi's must be 0. That's easy thing. Some power raised to 1 by p is 0 means the summation itself is 0. But the summation is all non-negative number. So each xi raised to p must be 0. Therefore, each xi must be 0. So the first part is totally obvious, right? The second thing is, if I multiply this one by scalar alpha, all the xi's will be multiplied by scalar alpha. This is just scalar x comma y raised to p modulus. Modulus of x comma y, first of all, is modulus of x to modulus. Raised to p is alpha raised to p into xi raised to p. Then alpha raised to p will come out here. When you take 1 by p at the root of that, it will be just modulus of alpha. Right? So that is the second one. So the first two, n1 and n2, are straightforward, right? Computation, little more analysis is needed to prove the third one, namely triangle inequality. The triangle inequality now becomes, for p, what it becomes? Modulus of xi plus yi raised to p, summation, and then take the p at root. It's less than or equal to individually you do the same thing for both x and y, namely xi raised to p summation, then raised to 1 by p plus yi raised to p summation, and then 1 by p. Right? So this is what you have to verify. This has a name, this is called Minkowski's inequality. Okay. It is not very straightforward, but it is not very difficult also. There are theories here. So these things are very nicely done in elementary real analysis books. So what I want you to do is, if you haven't seen it, please read it from that book. I am assuming that you know already a bit of real analysis. Real analysis courses will do have this kind of things. Okay. There are many books. If you don't know, you can approach me, then I will tell you exactly some books also. No problem. So we shall leave it to you to read the proof of this Minkowski inequality from any elementary analysis book. Okay. Of particular interest for us is the cases where p equal to 1 and p equal to 2. When you put p equal to 1, what is it? You have to take modulus of xi raised to 1. So there is no, you don't have to write. Take the summation and then take the 1th root. 1th root is same thing. So it is just summation modulus of xi. The second one which we started with, what is called as Euclidean norm. Started with the observation that how it happens, what it happens in R cross R, namely in the plane. Okay, summation xi square. Okay, if they are real numbers, you don't need to put modulus, but it's complex numbers also, it's valid. So you can get z1, z2, then mod z1 you have to take, mod z1 square plus mod z2 square you have to take, then take the square root. So that is Euclidean norm. Okay. The first one, this is, we would call it as L1 norm, is 1, 2, 3, etc., or PLP, that is the what we have, LP spaces, LP norm. So this is L2 norm, this L1 norm. This L1 norm has a different name, it's called taxicab norm. This was actually introduced by Jordan. Okay, and before that, people were usually thinking of this one single norm. This was something contribution from Jordan. Okay, very simple-minded thing. There were now many other norms which you will have to study. So these examples generalize immediately and effortlessly to the case when V is an infinite direct sum of copies of K. Finite or no, direct sum of copies of K is what? It is, say, z1, comma, z2, comma, zn, and then 0, 0, 0. So where you want to stop, nobody tells you. So if it's only k power n, then you have to stop at z1, z2, zn, n, n tuples, right? So that is the infinite direct sum. It could be count uncountable also, then you can't write it as z1, z2, zn. You have to write z alpha, where alpha is an indexing set for something and so on. So, but at each vector, only finitely many entries will be non-zero. So you can take, you can add, you can take the modulus of them, you can take the raised to p, then you can add, then all these things make sense immediately. And everything works because each time you have to restrict it to only finitely many. So if you have proved Minkowski inequality, okay, other things are just easy. Or now, right now, you think of that, you have proved it, then you can apply it. Okay. Now, there is another interesting case, namely, it's not direct sum or anything. This LP is infinite sequences of real or complex number, such that when you take this sum, you see, if it's finite sum, there is no problem. If it's infinite sum, what you have to do? You have to say it's convergent. Okay. Now it becomes very crucial that I assume p is between 1 and infinity. Otherwise, Minkowski inequality will not be true. Okay, other things are okay, but because infinity will not work. So we belong to 1 to infinity of take. Then look at all this LP, that is notation now. L upper P, remember, L lower P was for the norm. L upper P was a space here. All sequences exist, okay, infinite sequences. All Xi's are inside K, okay. Summation, modulus, is absolute convergence, modulus raised to P, Pth power, that must be finite. Take such a thing, to take two of them, the sum will be also finite, Minkowski inequality. It will prove to prove that this is an LP, this is a vector space. Alpha times this is finite is obvious. Okay, so it is vector space. In proving this is vector space itself, you can use Minkowski inequality. Okay, so all that you have to do is you replace this n here by infinity. To justify what you have to do, you have to show that these are convergent and so on. Okay, once you made it convergent, you have made it as a hypothesis here. You have put this hypothesis. So finally, what you have is why this one is true for when you have infinity, you take just the limit. It is true for each n. Okay, it is true for partial sums, so you can take the limit. Then for the limit also, it will be true. Okay, you don't have to prove Minkowski inequality separately for the convergent things, that will automatically follow. All right. So we have all these L upper P spaces. What are they? They are convergent sequences. Convergence is with respect to this P. Modulus of summation xi raised to P, summation x, sorry, modulus xi raised to P summation. So those systems converge. Okay. There is one more interesting thing. Don't worry about convergence, but put another condition, just a weaker condition, namely all those sequences which are bounded by some number. See, when you have infinite sequence, you don't know. You make a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it can keep going. You don't want bounded. Okay. Take real or complex number, no problem. Take only bounded sequences. Then you can talk about supremum. Remember, supremum is not the same thing as maximum, because we are taking infinite sets here. Okay, supremum will be also some finite number because it's a bounded sequence. You put that supremum as this norm x infinity. But it is just a symbol. Here I am not taking P first and then taking the limit. Okay, in some sense that is also true if you understand the geometry. But this is just a symbol here for a suprema. Okay. Now verifying n1 and n2 is easy as before. Verifying n3 is also easier here. You think about it, if you haven't done it, these are not difficult. For the supremum, you don't need a lot of analysis. It's elementary, you know, inequalities will do. So that will give you Minkowski inequality, something corresponding Minkowski inequality, which I call it as triangle inequality in this case, okay, for norm x infinity. So n3 will be also easy here. So this is called L infinity norm or sometimes supernorm. Okay. Yeah, so if you take a vector subspace of vector space which has a norm, then everything works for this vector subspace also. If you just restrict the function, norm function, to the subspace, that way you will get another nonlinear space. Okay, so for example, you can take this Kn itself sitting inside all these L infinity spaces. How? Kn is what? Kn is just Z1, Z2, Zn. Then put zeros. So a finite sequence can be made into an infinite sequence know, extending by putting extra zeros. Okay, so then take the maximum norm, supremum norm, various things. All links are there already. LP norms will be LP norms on KN. But now I get one extra thing which I had not done, namely the supremum norm becomes maximum. The maximum of modulus of X on X. Okay, so that is called norm X infinity, the same symbol because it's restricted. But now it has a different name on the right hand side because it's maximum. Supremum becomes maximum. Okay, only when these things are finite dimensional vector spaces. So here is a remark about these LP spaces, which just for getting, because these are examples that I am giving you, I am telling, but you should be learning these things in analysis. But let me just explain this point, because I may sometimes use this one, namely, if P is less than Q, then LP is contained inside LQ. What is the meaning of that? If a sequence, if a series, summation xn, is convergent after raising power p, you know, absolute convergence raised to power p, then it will be convergent if you take q also. Why this is? This is just a comparison test. See, a sequence which is convergent like this, since I am taking modulus here, you can always assume they are real number, positive real numbers. Okay, so it is absolute convergence, positive real numbers. So any positive real number summation convergence means after a certain stage, okay, these things must be small. In fact, limit of xn as n tends to infinity must be zero. So they are smaller than one. Therefore, when you take a higher power, it will be smaller. Therefore, each xn raised to q after a certain stage will be smaller than xn raised to p. Therefore, if this is convergent, this will be also convergent. So that is the comparison test here. Okay. So this is elementary analysis. So I have given you full explanation here. Okay. Why, if you take a sequence like this, it will be, this one will also convergent. Convergence of such a thing, 1 divided by n raised to s, for example, okay, you have to use, why this convergent? If and only if s is bigger than 1. You take this sequence, okay, 1 by n raised to s, between, where s is between 1 by q and 1 by p, this sequence will be inside LQ, but not inside LP. That will give you that LP is contained inside LQ, but there are points in LQ which are not in LP. So containment is strict here. Okay. One single example wherein S you have to choose correctly. Okay. So 1 divided by n raised to s. This is a beautiful example. This series itself is very important. Okay. So containment is fine, but there are some other kind of relations also, close relations between LP norms. So now I'm coming to the geometric aspect of this one. Look at just the numbers 1, 2, 3, p, and then infinity. Don't worry about the in-between real numbers there. Only take the integers, okay? Just to concentrate on what's going on, not for the sake of, logical statement, just for getting some ideas, okay? You can take 1.5 and so on. That may be more difficult to imagine what is happening. So just take these numbers. Look at this picture. This is in R2, okay? Because I am drawing a picture means it has to be the plane, right? So plane is R2, R3, R4, etc., difficult to imagine. Okay, so what is this picture? This square here. This is set of all points x, y, such that modulus of x plus modulus of y is less than or equal to 1. This is x plus y less than or equal to 1. You can say this is 0, which is x axis, this y axis, right? But what is this one? This is the circle. What is this last thing? This is the maximum of x comma y modulus. Okay, modulus of x comma y is less than or equal to 1. So all these things are unit disks inside corresponding LP spaces. This is L1, this is L2, the standard Euclidean. This is L3 or L2 or L5, I don't know. I have only drawn one of them. Then this last one is L infinity. So you see, now if you keep on taking bigger and bigger, this line becomes flatter and flatter, like this keeps going. So in the limiting case, it will become the outer square. In that sense, L infinity is actually the limiting of these things. That is what I meant earlier. Okay. So these are D2 for, you know, n equal to 2, P for the P norm, or x belong to R2, that norm of x is less than or equal to 1. So various disks I have shown. Okay. So when P is smaller, the corresponding disk is also smaller. This is L1, this is smallest one, which is contained in all of them. As P increases, they become increasing, you know, bigger and bigger, and finally it will become a square like this. So that is the picture in R2. Similar pictures you can see in all n. Okay. So that I can't draw, but I can make this conclusion. If P is less than Q, norm of XQ is always less than or equal to same, X is same. Okay. Norm of XP. The Qth norm and LQ norm is less than LP norm. So this is easy to verify. Okay. Argument is similar to what we have done. This kind of argument you have to use. So this is roughly for today. There is a little more deeper relations between these LP spaces, interrelation. So that we'll investigate a little later. Okay. Thank you.